chapter 10, verse 29. You may have, if you checked your church Facebook site, you may have already seen that the topic this morning, the subject, the name of the lesson is A Hair's Breadth Away. A Hair's Breadth Away. And I read Matthew chapter 10, beginning at 29 through 31. And he spake to them a parable. I'm sorry, I just jumped over to another scripture I want to read into Luke, but I want Matthew chapter 10, verse 29. Are not two sparrows sold for a farthing? And one of them shall not fall on the ground without your Father. But the very hairs of your head are numbered. Fear ye not, therefore, ye are of more value than many sparrows. Now, for some of the younger ones in our congregation who may not be familiar with that saying, it's a hair's breadth away, or I just missed failing that test by a hair breadth, or I came within a hair breadth of having an accident on Highway 80. What that means is an exceedingly small measure of time or distance. It means that we came as close as we could to something happening without it actually happening. So that is kind of the setting for our lesson this morning, A Hair's Breadth Away. There are three things I'd like to tell you about out of this lesson. The first thing is divine possession. Divine possession. The next thing is divine purpose. Divine purpose. And the third part of the lesson is divine, and I love this, I suppose, more than anything else, divine preservation. Divine preservation. So look at verse 30, if you would, where Jesus said, but the very hairs of your head are numbered. Now, unfortunately, this scripture has been laughed at, thought about, made fun of with things like, well, I don't have many hairs on my head, so God doesn't have a lot of things to number, or I'm bald, so I guess that the very hairs on my head being numbered are no great challenge for God, or, well, isn't our God smart that he knows every hair on my head? I want to tell you, it's nothing like that. What Jesus is saying is, has nothing to do with numbers. It means that every hair on our head is accounted for. It means that regardless of the number, which is not important, God so loves us that this minuscule little part of us is part of his divine inventory. And he considers it very, very important. Now, we don't ordinarily think of God's ownership of things in terms of something as small as a hair on my head. But what comfort we can derive in that. If God takes into account something as small and thin and it's not all that important as a hair on my head, how must he feel about the rest of me? Oh, that psalmist wrote it in Psalm 139 in a way that it's been written nowhere else. In Psalm 139, verses 13 and 6 through 16, David wrote this. divine ownership of even the smallest part of me. For thou hast possessed my reins. Thou hast covered me in my mother's womb. I will praise thee, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are thy works, and that my soul knoweth right well. My substance, and that's every bit of me. That's every little hair, every little whisker. For thou hast possessed my reins, hast covered me in my mother's womb. I will praise thee, for I am fearfully and wonderful made. Wonderful are thy works, and that my soul knows quite well. My substance was not hid from thee when I was made in secret and curiously wrought in the lowest parts of the earth. Thine eyes did see my substance. Your eyes, God's eyes, saw every bit of me, from my ears to my toes, and to every hair that would ever grow on my head. God saw that, and he deemed it very, very important. Thine eyes did see my substance, yet being unperfect. And in thy book all my members, everything about me were written, which is in continuance were fashioned, when as yet there was none of them. Before there was a head, before there was a heart, before there was a brain stem. We read here that even before then you saw every little bit of me, and it was important to you. And do you know, when God saved you and you and you, he saved all of you. He just didn't save your heart. He just didn't save your brain, all those important things. He saved the last hair on your head, because he deems it so important as to recount the fact that he made it all and owns it all. As a matter of fact, this is such great comfort that God has ownership of all of me, that it is written in Isaiah, if you will, Isaiah chapter 43. And verses 1 and 2. Isaiah 43 and verses 1 and 2. But now thus saith the Lord that created thee, O Jacob, and he that formed thee. O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed thee. I have called thee by thy name, and thou art mine. Did you hear that? I formed you. I made you. I own you. And so now you can fear not, for I have redeemed all of you. All that bursitis that you have in the knee, and that knee that gives you such a fit, God owns that knee. And he loves that knee as much as any other part of you, because you are his divine possession. But then look at the divine purpose in all of that. But the very hairs of your head are all numbered. God's will and purpose is involved in everything. The old ones weren't afraid to call that predestination. And that is that God is involved in everything. That is everything. But the context here in which we read regarding God's divine purpose and the very hairs of your head being numbered, the context here is about the dangers that the disciples were going to face. He was sending them out into the world. He was sending them out to preach the gospel. And I want to tell you, if you think ISIS is something new to our generation. It is not. There were those in the days of these disciples that Jesus was sending out every bit as wicked and antagonistic toward Christianity and toward the Christ of Christianity is that terrible, dark cancer that is creeping across the Mideastern part of the world. And Jesus said, I'm sending you out into that. I'm sending you into the teeth of the ISISes of the world. And he says, don't forget this. In all of that, fear not. Now, there's three times in this context where Jesus said, fear not, you'll notice. Verse 26, he says to these disciples facing these dangers, and it's not lost on you and me either. In verse 26, fear them not, therefore, for there's nothing covered that shall not be revealed and hid that shall not be known. Fear not, because nothing is going to happen in secret. I am there and I know. You know, there's two words in the book of Revelation that I really take comfort in. Two words. And that is when Jesus says, I know. No one else may know. No one else may appreciate the hard time that you're going through. But this one thing you can be assured of. The God who takes into account every hair on your head knows. So fear not, he tells his disciples. Listen to Psalm 139, if you will. Psalm 139, again, listen to this. Psalm 139, verses begin. Beginning at verse 1, O Lord, you've searched me and known me. You've known my down sitting and my uprising, that thou understandest my thought afar off. When I sit down and when I stand up, and for some of you that's not so easy. And I'm about ready to join you. But you, Lord, are there. You compass my path in my lying down, and you're acquainted with all my ways. Fear not, because there's nothing that's in secret. For there is not a word in my tongue, but lo, O Lord, thou knowest it altogether. Thou hast beset me behind and before, and laid thy hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It's high. I cannot attain to it. But whither shall I go from thy spirit? Whither shall I flee from thy appearance, from thy presence? If I ascend to heaven, you're there. If I make my bed in the lowest depths of the earth, you are there. I think of those astronauts, that beloved group, the first group that took the teacher into space. And that thing just blew all the smithereens up there. Nothing left except the trash that fell to the sea. But you know what? God was there. Every soul aboard that and the later casualty that happened up there, the hair of every soul on those spaceships were accounted for, and God was there. Even there shall your hand lead me, thy right hand shall hold me. If I say, surely the darkness shall cover me, and the night be light about me, yet the darkness hides not from thee, the night shineth as the day. The darkness and the light are both alike to thee. So Jesus says, fear not, because nothing is going to happen in secret. The next fear not is verse 28. And fear not them which kill the body, but are able to kill the soul, but are not able to kill the soul, but rather fear him which is able to destroy both soul and body in hell. Here is the fear not Because your ultimate destiny is in the hands of God and not men. Men are always going to treat you properly. You're going to have those of you in the service, know that there were those who wanted to kill you, who wanted a bullet to bring your life to an end. But I'll tell you this, there are also those that would want to defame you, bring your reputation to nothing, to hurt you, to bring you down because they're jealous of you. But I'll tell you this, it is not man that has the ultimate say, it is God that has the ultimate say. And I'll tell you, justice does not end here on earth. Justice is in the hands of God. So fear not, because your ultimate destiny is in no man's hand but in God's. And then the 31st verse, fear not because of your value to God. Fear not, therefore, you're more valuable than many sparrows. Now, this is something you got to think about, folks. Jesus gives us here in these examples from nature, these very real examples. They're not made up examples. These aren't even parables. These are realities regarding your worth to God. Verse 29 says, two sparrows are sold for a farthing, and a farthing is not any more than a penny. And one of them shall not fall to the ground without your Father. How about that? Two sparrows for a penny, and not one of them falls to the ground without your Father. But then there's a Kmart or Walmart special thrown in, a Black Friday special thrown in. In Luke chapter 12, In Luke chapter 12, verse 6, here's a real bargain for those of you buying a sparrow. And by the way, sparrows were the food of very, very poor people in Jesus' day. Here's you a better deal. Are not five sparrows sold for two farthings, and not one of them is forsaken before God? So you can get two for a penny, or you can get five for two pennies, giving you one extra thrown in. So that's not a bad deal, is it? But what Jesus is giving here is how little worth a sparrow has. But yet, not one of them is beyond our Lord's watchful eye. Not one of them falls to the ground without your Father. Now, there's two things being taught here. One of them you're very familiar with, but the other one you're not so familiar with, and that other one is probably the one you're going to take away from this service this morning as the most valuable to you. And of course, the first thing about this not one sparrow falling to the ground without your Father has to do with death. And that's what the disciples faced. They faced death. All of them except John were going to be martyred, put to death. So you see, Jesus says, not one sparrow falls without your Father, and not one of you are going to fall in death without your Father. Has anyone ever seen a bird drop dead out of a tree? Not shot now. Have any of you ever seen a bird just keel over and drop dead out of a tree? Folks, I've been on this planet for 72 years and I've never seen that. I've watched the birds in my backyard with awe, and I've never seen one sitting on a branch and then just keel over with a heart attack and fall to the ground. Have you seen that? No, but we know birds die, don't we? I don't know where they go. I don't know how they do it, but I want to tell you this. Most people on the face of this planet have never seen a bird die a natural death. But God has. He sees them, everyone. They may go to a secret place that you and I don't know about, there to give up their little birdie ghost. But God sees them, everyone. So the other lesson, though, here regards not death, but life. You know, actually, birds don't usually drop dead out of a tree. I did do a little research on that. Most birds are killed by predators. They're in the food chain. The ones that ever make it from the egg to the little bird in the nest are in a minority. And those that go from the little bird in the nest to actually parenthood and becoming productive members of the bird family, they're in the minority. Most birds don't die like that. But here's what happens. The predators get them. Now, birds do fall to the ground. And in the original, and you can look this up, it's right there. In the original, that means to light on the ground. They leave the safety of the limb, and they come down in search of food, and they hop around, and while they're doing that, they're easy targets for their predators. The most risky time in a bird's life is while they're hopping around on the ground. They are most vulnerable. And here's the thing about those little birds. There's dangers everywhere around them that want them for dinner, and the little rascals don't even know about it. Danger is a hairbreadth away for every bird that hops on the face of the earth, and they're not even aware of it. But you know what? My Bible says that God is. And so the lesson teaches us that if the little sparrow is deemed that important in the purposes of God, how much more the sheep of his pasture? No, not one of them is forgotten before God. And lastly, divine preservation. But the very hairs of your head are numbered. In this same account, in Luke 21, Jesus says, but there shall, in verse 18, there shall not a hair of your head perish. Not a head of your head to perish. And what is he saying? That we'll never go bald? That things won't happen to us that will cause us to lose our hair? That parents won't pull their hair out from kids not doing as they should? No, 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 no. Here's the same thing. There is not one hair that is going to go unaccounted for. If one falls like a sparrow, God knows it. I'm getting where I hate to take a shower anymore because I literally plug the drain with hair that's supposed to be there, but ends up there. But such as is my importance to God, and such is his divine preservation of me, that not one of my hairs is going to go without him knowing. The psalmist saw that in Psalm 42 verse 9. He said, you know, it's amazing, and here's that divine preservation. It's amazing, but even my own friends that I trust, which eat my bread, have done me harm, or who will do me harm. right there in their own homes, among family and friends, these disciples were going to get depraved. They were going to get betrayed. Matthew 10:21, right there in the context of what we're reading here, the brother shall deliver a brother to death, and the father the child, and the children shall rise up against their parents and cause them to be put to death. All of this is going to happen. And you know, even today, the dangers often that lurk only a hair breadth away are right under our nose where we would least expect it. Without knowing it, even where they felt the safest, they were a hair's breadth from harm. But there again, Christ uses the hair on our head to illustrate his protection of us. Perish there, in the scripture I read to you, not a hair perishing, means it won't be lost or unaccounted for. It's that important. That hair that falls is not lost. Our God knows it. And when you have your hard time and you face your danger, that thing is not lost and it's accounted for. You know, there were two young Hebrew men. Who were they? They faced the flame. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. They faced the flame. They stood up to Nebuchadnezzar, as many of you are going to have to do, many before you go on to be with the Lord. And in that book where it is recorded in Daniel, chapter 3, Nebuchadnezzar, because these boys didn't do what he wanted them to do and stayed faithful to God, he had them put to a furnace where they were to be incinerated. And they went forth, verse 26 of this third chapter says, then Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were in the fire, but they came forth in the midst of the fire, and the princes and governors and captains and the kings and the counselors gathered together. And they saw these men upon whose bodies the fire had no power. Listen to this. Nor was a hair of their head singed. God could have let the hair get singed anyway. By preserving them, you know, they could have lost their whiskers. But God valued these boys so much that even the hair on their head were counted worthy of preserving. And so what a profound effect that had on Nebuchadnezzar. And nothing has changed since then, brothers and sisters. You're subject to fires of peril, most of which you can't possibly know. I think of every time I'm on Highway 80 out there, how close I am to a car coming across that lane and ending it all. A very, very reality of how we're a hair's breadth away from danger. Yet did our Lord say that when we go through the fire, how did he put it? In Isaiah 43, how did he put it? Put it this way, and I hope you've got this underlined. When you pass through the waters, I'll be with thee. Through the rivers, they'll not overflow thee. When you walk through the fire, thou shalt not be burned, neither shall the flame kindle upon thee. You know why? Because such is the power and the purpose and the preserving grace of God, that not a hair of your head will go unaccounted for now and on the resurrection morning. It'll all be there, yet in a renewed, perfect state. May the Lord add His blessing is my prayer for Christ's sake, and amen.